Welcome to QDL. QDL is your look at who and what is making news in the world of quality. I'm Dirk Ducharme, Editor-in-Chief of Quality Digest. We continue to hear in the news that workers are leaving their jobs in larger numbers than in the past. According to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, even though the percent of people quitting their jobs has been steadily increasing since 2009, so this isn't really a new phenomena, the last part of 2021 has seen a very sharp spike in quits. About 3% of all non-farm labor quit their jobs in September, and about 6.4% in leisure and hospitality. This translates to about 4.4 million Americans quitting their jobs in September. So that rate is much higher than it has been. The reason people quit their jobs is complex, and it would be really naive to try to point to any one thing, right? It's a confluence of events and policies over the years, but it is probably not a coincidence that the Great Resignation, or the Big Quit, as it's called sometimes, has followed on the tail of the pandemic. The question is, what did remote work expose that has led so many people to retire or change jobs? Well, with us today to share her insights is Mary Elizabeth Elcordy, founder and president of Elcordy Global Strategies, a full-service boutique PR firm that actually launched amid the COVID-19 crisis. Hi, Mary Elizabeth. Thanks for joining us.
Hi. Thank you so much for having me.
Hey, great. Well, before we get started, I mean, as I just said, you actually launched your company in the middle of the pandemic. So were you part of the big quit? Were you kind of part of what we're going to be talking about today?
I actually was part of the big layoff. but I was already freelancing before I left my previous job. And I was in that process of making a decision to, I knew I needed to start my company because I was doing more work on the side than my day job, but it's scary, you know, leaving your job. So the pandemic kind of forced me and propelled me to do things I was scared to do. And I'm glad in some ways everything happens for a reason. So while I don't wish anyone gets laid off, it worked out for me.
Okay, perfect. So why, in your opinion, are so many Americans leaving their jobs right now? It's been really this spike we've seen over the last 3 months or so.
Well, I think right now the pandemic has changed the way Americans understand living and working from where, when, how, and why they do their work. And, you know, over the past 20 months, people have really taken a pause in their lives and really reevaluated what they want to do, especially for those that are considered non-essential jobs, but have been at their jobs for years and thought they were secure. We have learned that there is no such thing as a secure job anymore, whether you were at it for 20 years or whether you were at it for a year. So now it's time for people to really assess, what do I want to do in life? And also with a lot of jobs now requiring people to come back to work, like for instance, Goldman Sachs, requiring people to come back to New York to have their New York office salaries, people are now really questioning, do I want to come back to a city? And with like different variants coming out every other week, it feels like, and also different family priorities. People got really used to being at home with their dog, like I have, or with their kids or their loved ones. And getting rid of a 2-hour commute every day. So there are specific aspects that people are really taking in. And then also, if they were already in a toxic work environment and they now have all these options because so many companies are now offering remote work or hybrid remote work, it really makes people wonder, like, do I really need to go back to a job I don't like doing? And lastly, with the art of the side hustle, like myself have taken advantage of, people can now make income outside of a normal 9-to-5 job through places like Upwork or Fiverr, or more companies are now looking to hire freelancers because it's more cost effective, because sometimes you hire someone full time and they may only work 25 hours a week. And so you're paying extra costs for no reason when you could have a freelancer do that time. Obviously, it's good to have full time people as an investment for the company, but for a lot of companies are now evaluating, like, how many full time people do I actually need compared to freelancers?
So Let's talk about that a little bit. What can employers do about this? I mean, if they want to, I guess there's two questions. If they want to keep their current employees from leaving, what do they need to do to kind of keep them in place? Or if they're trying to attract new employees, what is it that they have to offer that maybe above and beyond what they've offered in the past?
So I think there are five different areas to really look at. So first of all, the topic of mental health has never been talked about more in terms of the workplace than it has been over the past 20 months. And I think with the challenges people have had in their personal lives due to the pandemic and how it's impacted their work, companies who are really seeing retention rates are really taking a moment to work on their team's mental health or providing mental health type of services or options. And that's also acknowledging how people tend to work more at home and communicate care for work-life balance. So for instance, if you know someone's working way above hours, to basically say like, hey, take a half day on Friday, or you know what, you have an extra day, you know, logged in for this year, right? Kind of acknowledging that most people who work at home tend to work more hours because their computer is so close to them that when they have nothing to do, they end up doing work.
Exactly.
But it has a long-term impact. And then also expanding opportunities for internal mobility for workers looking to try something new. So for instance, in my company, I always, you know, the door is always open if someone has an idea or a potential client they want to bring, giving people the ability to be a little bit entrepreneurial. I think a lot of people have had those moments this past year where they've learned that, hey, I can be an entrepreneur on my own. Why am I going to go to a company? And so it's giving that type of optimism and openness where you allow new ideas to come in and let people take a little bit of ownership of something that they might want to grow themselves. And then last but not least, provide remote culture options. I think it's hard to create a culture remotely. I think that's something that we've struggled with at the beginning. How do you create a sense of family or friendship or teamwork within a company where you don't see people? And so I think it's really figuring out what works best for your team. We have people who we work with all over the world. So creating that type of friendly environment across time zones, across culture differences is very important. And now that while there are variants coming out, more and more people have the ability to travel, you know, finding other ways of creating bonding moments. So for us, I don't see the need to invest in an office. I'd rather spend that money creating memories. So whether that we do a yearly retreat or it's a holiday party where I fly people out, right, where people get to meet each other in a way that is conducive of building memories and building bonding moments that end up helping the job more so than me having a physical office.
You know, you talk about culture, and part of me thinks about management and the way management typically works, and even the way we kind of monitor work for employees, right. You know. So typically it's, you know, you come to work or you punch your clock and you work 40 hours and you leave, and hopefully during that 40 hours you've finished the tasks that you supposed to have needed to get finished in that 40 hours. Well, now there is no really, there can be, but there's a lot of pushback on it, no real need to punch a clock. So is management having to change their mind on what work really is? And is it working 40 hours a week, or is it simply work how much time you need to complete this set of tasks? And if it's 20, that's awesome. If it's 30, that's great.
I think it really depends on what your workforce structure looks like. If you have a whole bunch of full-time employees, obviously if they work a little bit less than 40 hours, but they get all of their work done, great, right? Because you're paying them that same amount no matter what.
Right.
Sometimes with the acknowledgement that once in a while they might have to put in a little bit more than 40 hours if it's a big week, right?
Right.
But then on the opposite end, if you have freelancers, if they're billing me 40 hours for 20 hours of work,
yeah.
I'm not a fan of that because that impacts the bottom line, right? And that's the whole point of having freelancers. So I think that there's still a 40-hour work week. I think it's just more so people have more flexibility in how they manipulate their 40-hour work week. So if you have kids, or like we hire like single moms or people who have special needs kids, right? They may not be able to do like the exact clock in, clock out at 9 to 5, but they may wake up at 7:30 to do some work and then pick up their kids at 1:30, right?
Right.
So I think it's more so, it's still 40 hours, but there's more flexibility and when you can do that time, as long as you have a really clear communication with your manager.
You know, looking at this from the other perspective, from the job seeker's point of view,
sure.
Do job seekers seem to be looking more, okay, so they've quit their job wherever it is for whatever reason, but now they, you know, they still need to work. Are they looking more toward shifting to a different employment, you know, what should I say,
a full-time
job where they work for an employee? Or is the tendency now just to be a gig worker and line up your gigs? I mean, what are people tending to prefer?
I think it's on both sides, actually. I think, at least from the experiences I've seen, that both the companies and freelancers want to test out whether that gig is something that they want, right? So a lot of the people that we hire, we bring in as a freelancer at first, and we see, is this something that they want to do? Is this something where they feel like they can grow, they can feel fulfilled, they can have the flexibility they want, but they're still producing good work and they can see themselves being here long term before I make that investment to make them full time.
Right.
I think on both sides, it's allowing both the employer and freelancer to really evaluate what's a good fit.
Okay.
And we've been lucky because most people have stayed. There haven't been really people that have left, unless they, you know, had personal things in their lives that changed. But I think it's really assessing what your goals are and what you're hoping out of your next 18 months. Because some people who work with us who are gig workers, like they're about, either about to have a kid or they wanted the flexibility to travel to different places. And so not having 40 hours, but maybe 25 hours fits better for their life. And it allows us to access really quality talent for a much more manageable cost, but also allows them to have the flexibility they need. So it's a nice give and take.
So if you were to give, since you're on both sides of this, you hire and you have your own employees, what advice would you give job seekers who are out there in the market now and it's kind of a whole new Wild West out there? What is the best thing they can be doing to enhance their possibilities for getting into a job that they're going to enjoy and that has the wages and the benefits that they want?
Sure. So I think, first of all, evaluate where you're at right now, right? Like, do you have a full-time job? Do you have an income? If you do, then I never suggest people make rash decisions that change your financial well-being. I didn't do that. You know, I was in a position where oftentimes you get pigeonholed in certain subject matters in the field that I'm in, which limits your ability for upward mobility or momentum. And so I started doing a lot of fintech PR on the side to really amp that up and to see, can I be my own boss, right? Is this something I even want to do? Or am I cool just making, you know, an extra $1,000 a month, which when you're like 27 years old is a lot, right? And an extra $1,000 or $2,000 is cool.
Sure.
But then you can either evaluate at that point, like, is this something I want to do that I'm doing on the side? Should I try something else? Because side hustles allow you to really, you know, create what you want to do in some ways. You get to test out different jobs or test out different fields. Obviously, you should have some experience. And, you know, there's a lot of online certificate courses and places where you can get education for free that can help you boost that credibility and obviously price lower at the beginning. So you can gain those reviews and that momentum. And then once you're at a point where you start having enough income on the side that you can feel comfortable to leave your day job and still pay the bills and still have a roof over your head and still be able to go out once in a while, then that's when I think people should take that leap. Now, if you're on the other end of the spectrum and you've lost your job, you still need something to get you by, right? So I would suggest evaluate what skills do you currently have, what skills do you want to have for the type of future you want, and then seeing how you can get there while, you know, whether it's a virtual assistant job on Upwork or you get a waiter job or whatever it is, so that you can actually start building those credentials. I have friends who have created such impressive side hustles that, you know, it's grown to the point where they could expand, but they just don't want to, right? They don't want to create a company. Yeah. And so it's also making that determination once you're at that point, like, do you just want to stay stagnant? And that's not a bad thing, where you just have consistent side income and you don't want to create a company or you don't want to expand, and then that's your decision, right? And so I think it's just really evaluating what you want in your life and how much time you want to put in. Because it's, while they say it's, you know, about quality work and quality time, which I preach all the time, it's also about how much time do you want to put in? You know, do you want to put in those 10,000 hours so you can become an expert?
Right. For your company, since, I mean, you're kind of in a unique position given when your company started and grew. So what kind of changes have you seen even during the pandemic in terms of how work is being approached? Maybe even just in your own company. It seemed like the whole thing is very mercurial and that things are just changing almost week to week in terms of what people want to do and what their expectations are. What's been your experience?
In terms of the client side or the employee side?
The employee side.
I think it's more so what I've noticed is that as people have buy-in into your company, they start envisioning wanting to be there for a while. So like whenever I go to a city where I have employees there, I always end up throwing a happy hour or something, or like something on the weekend. And I've had employees say to me, it's not often where I tell my friends, hey, you want to come hang out with my boss? Right?
This is like, yeah, pretty rare.
It's true. I've never wanted to do that. Or like we had our holiday party was like a 3-day weekend in New York. And I had someone say, I never thought I would spend a 3-day weekend with my boss and like their coworkers and have a great time. Yeah. And, you know, those moments, while, you know, they cost money and it sounds frivolous, it actually creates such loyalty because you actually get to know one another in a way that I don't think any job I've ever had or many have had. So I think what I've noticed is that with these little culture things that we do and we've had people who've left us to go to different companies and still do a little work for us and then come back in a bigger way because they've realized what's out there is much rougher than what we do, right, in terms of how we treat our employees. So I think if you treat your employees well, if you give them opportunities for genuine bonding where people can just be their most authentic self, you value them for that and really embrace it. Like it's like when you're in a relationship, you don't want to change the person. You want to make them the best version of themselves.
Right.
And so that's my goal with anyone that comes to our company. And so I find that by doing these little things that may seem trivial at the time, have actually created people we have a wait list of people who want to go full time on our freelance side.
That's awesome.
Right. I've never seen anything like that happen. Yeah. But we also treat our freelancers well, right? We give them full, you know, we give them holidays off for like, you know, national holidays. They're eligible for incremental raises, right? And so because understanding that we're in a more freelance environment, there's still people who have families, who have needs. And so while they may not have the ability to commit to 40 hours because of personal circumstances, they still do awesome work. And I think as long as you're able to recognize that and value that, you'll see people stay. And that's what I've noticed.
So that's,
really.
That's interesting. So it sounds like you treat your contract employees like employees. I mean,
they don't get 10 days off.
Oh, yeah, and, yeah, right.
But like even like our full-time employees, like PR is a field where there's often a lot of burnout.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we give people between Christmas and New Year's off every year. Or if you've been with us for a couple of years, you get the July 4th week off. So we understand that sometimes you're going to work more than an 8-hour day. It happens in any full-time job. Right. But I've worked in so many places, from working in newsrooms to working at other firms, where it's expected that on the regular you're working till 8.
Okay.
Right. So, and that's just not healthy long term.
Where do you see this a year from now, 2 years from now? What do you envision the workplace looking like?
I see the workplace looking like there's a lot of what do you call it? Those trial periods. I see trial periods being a big thing. And not when you hear like Steve Harvey say like the three month rule for work. I see it more as it's an invest. People think like, my mom passed away last year, right, from COVID, and it's terrible and it sucked. But since then, I've always valued time, but time is so precious, right? It's the one commodity that you can't get back, right? And so I think a lot of people with a lot of families going through tragedies, or people at near death experiences, or whatever normal amounts of terrible moments happening in people's year, people really evaluate the time that they're doing with spending on things. And so I think on both the company and employee side, as I mentioned earlier, people are going to be trying to test out the waters a little bit more instead of just jumping headfirst into an opportunity. And I really suggest that. And I also see more people taking time to better themselves education wise, which I'm always a fan for. I mean, I'm getting my second grad degree now because I'm a super nerd. But it's also really important that people take that time and energy, the time that they would have spent traveling to commute to work, if they spend that time bettering themselves every day, educating themselves every day, whether it's half an hour, an hour, 2 hours, even if it's picking up a book, it's only going to help them advance. And it's something, education is something that you can never take away. So I think it's increased amount of focus on education. And I find that more and more people I host training sessions every week in digital marketing, and then I'm about to start doing one in crypto. I'm finding more and more people just on my team want to attend because they want to learn. They're hungry to be able to do other things, right? And they normally don't have those opportunities. And then I think it's the testing out what makes most sense for them, because it's in terms of, you know, starting 25 hours at a company and just seeing where it goes, and they can test out a couple of opportunities, to be honest, if they wanted to. So I think it allows people to really embrace their full self.
All right. Well, Mary Elizabeth Elkerty, founder and president of Elkerty Global Strategies, thanks for joining us today. Really, really appreciate you taking the time.
Of course. Well, thank you so much for having me.
Sure. And that is it for today's QDL. Thanks to all of you for joining us. If there's somebody you would like us to bring on the show, or some topic you would like us to cover, just let us know. Email us at qdl@qualitydigest.com and we will do our best. So thanks once again for joining us, and we will see you at the next QDL. So long.